So now we are back to the wholly obtained or produced. So to qualify as originating, we know it must either be completely born and raised, completely manufactured from all the materials. So 100% NAFTA. Complete tariff shift. Successfully, or must be wholly obtained and produced. All right, so let's talk about what this buzzword, and I put this in quotation marks because this is a term of art, what this buzzword means, wholly obtained and produced. So number five says goods, fish, shellfish, and other marine life taken from the sea by the vessel, registered and recorded with an NAFTA party, and flying its flag. So pretty much it goes to the general concept of country of origin, which we started which we opened up our chapter on country of origin, where we talked about that Norwegian vessel flag. So it goes to the basic rule. If the something is cut in the international waters, something is taken without, not within, but without borders of that particular national sovereign territory, then the it acquires nationality of whatever vessel under which flag it is registered. So if it's cut by the U.S. vessel, its country of origin is the United States. So here we have NAFTA party flying its flag. So if a Mexican ship in international waters of Pacific Ocean which would catch fish, it would be qualified for NAFTA origin, at least wholly obtained and produced concept. There is also a marking concept, right? Because we're going under the originating. Now, let's take a look at the next exam question. Josie has decided to start an importing business. She can't decide which product she would like to import, but she wants to take advantage of NAFTA. Which of the following is a good of NAFTA country? So you have asparagus grown and harvested in Belize and packed in Mexico. See, so asparagus is a vegetable product, right? And vegetable product must be harvested in the territory of NAFTA party. And Belize is not a NAFTA party, Mexico is. So packing it mere itself will not do any good. Harvesting must be done in Mexico. And because of this, because Belize is there, it will disqualify, the Belize itself disqualifies asparagus, which is grown and harvested in Belize, from NAFTA application. We also have tuna, which is cut on a Japanese registered flag vessel and packaged in a plastic bag on a Mexican registered vessel and flag factory ship. See, factory ship, the goal of the factory ship is you have to have factory ship stuff that are being done. You have to have production. You have to have substantial transformation taking place before you can qualify, right? Here, all that is being done to the tuna is the packaging, right? Nothing else. No processing. There is no making of fillet. You just merely package the product, right? So because of that, it remains its Japanese identity because it was cut on a Japanese registered and flag vessel. So the country of origin is Japan, and Japan is not North American Free Trade Agreement country. So B is not our answer choice. Then you have a sheep in the answer choice C, which is born in Chile and raised in Mexico. So so sheep is a livestock, and with respect to live animals, born and raised, it must be a live animal born and raised in the territory of NAFTA party. A little clarification note. So live animals can also be obtained by hunting, right? But I think over here, the point is domesticated live animals. Even though they don't say that, this is the implication, because if you go for the wild animal, let's say you got it from state of Chiapas, right, in Mexico. How do you know that it was born and raised in the territory of South Mexico, right? Maybe it was in Guatemala, right? They just crossed the border. Wild animals do not know that national borders. They just travel along. Sometimes they travel along as a pattern, right? Let's say birds, right? They do the migrations all the time. So let's say you went out hunting and you killed a bird. How do you know it was born and raised in Mexico, right? It might have been just following a migratory pattern. So really, I think this section refers to the wild stuff, and this section refers to the domesticated stuff. And of course, domesticated animals, there is not that many of them. You have sheep, you have cattle, like cows. You have llamas, right? Llamas are domesticated animals. You have dogs, you have cats, you have horses, quails. Some, I remember there was, when I was just fresh out of the law school, I had to take a bar exam, and I was taking a lecture, and it was related to torts, like personal injury stuff. So I remember there was also a question, wild versus domesticated, because if a person keeps the wild animals, the duty of safekeeping that wild animal is higher than the duty of, let's say, keeping a domesticated animal. So the question that came up is like, define a wild versus domesticated. So obviously, like bears would be wild, but then the question came up: are the bees a wild animal, right? Or are they domesticated? Because bees exist both in the wild, and they produce honey, right? So it was kind of like a borderline. So I'll leave it up to you to figure out if the bees are domesticated or not. But the point is the list of domesticated animals is quite short. And sheep, as we saw in this customs broker exam question, is definitely a domesticated animal. So it must be born and raised in Mexico, Canada, or the United States to claim NAFTA preference. So Chile kills NAFTA for that poor sheep, which happened to be born in Chile. Now, gold mineral in Colombia with Mexican mining equipment. So the focus is not on the equipment, but the focus is on its extraction. So gold is a mineral, right? And it must be extracted in the territory of Canada, Mexico, or the United States. So just the fact that it uses Mexican mining equipment does not change the fact that Colombia is not a member of the NAFTA club. So since it was extracted in the territory of Colombia, it precludes it from the North American Free Trade Agreement preferential duty treatment. Then you have abalone, taken by Mexican registered and flag vessel from the seabed in Ecuadorian waters with Ecuador's permission. All right, so you have abalone. Abalone is a mollusk, right? So if we go to, let's take a look. All right, so we're talking about the shellfish, the mollusk, right? Apparently, it's I'm not that familiar with this type of seafood, but apparently this is something that is for consumption, and it is taken by Mexican registered and flying vessel from the seabed of Ecuadorian water. So, because it is registered in Mexico, it is good enough, and we know that because we have that rule for the goods. The shellfish in this case, right, or marine life, which is abalone, taken from the seabed by vessels registered and recorded in a NAFTA party and flying its flag, in this case, Mexico, which is a member state. It was taken from the seabed in Ecuadorian waters with Ecuador's permission. Well, the point is over here. This is if it was there was no permission, if there was no license, maybe, right? But recall going back to our first very beginning of the lecture, right? When we discussed what does it mean to be a territory of Mexico, right? The continental shelf. The waters. See, remember we discussed G here, that territory of Mexico includes any areas beyond the territorial seas of Mexico, within which, in accordance with international law, including the United Nations Convention on the Law of Sea, and its domestic law, Mexico may exercise the rights with respect to seabed and subsoil of their natural resources, So, in other words, because the international law, meaning that you have the agreement between Ecuador and Mexico to conduct certain exploration activities, certain hunting activities, certain fishing activities, so that would be an example of making the product qualifying for the NAFTA good under this particular example. So, therefore, this good will qualify for NAFTA because it is Mexican registered vessel and because there was Ecuador's permission and that was in accordance with international law.